Chapter 11 of Abraham Lincoln, A History, Volume 8. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Florence Short. Abraham Lincoln, A History, Volume 8, by John Hay and John George Nicolay. Chapter 11, O Lusty and the Red River. The war, during the early part of 1864, brought little of glory or profit to the Union arms. There were numberless marches and countermarches, many insignificant engagements resulting in nothing, but the only events not otherwise mentioned, which are especially worth recording, were two somewhat serious reverses to the national cause, both of them in the southernmost tier of the states, one in Florida and one in Louisiana. Early in the winter of 1863-64, General Gillmore, commanding the Department of the South, announced to the government at Washington his intention of beginning active operations in his department, and was authorized to act according to his own judgment and discretion. He therefore resolved upon an expedition into Florida to take possession of such portions of the eastern and northern sections of the state as could be easily held by small garrisons. He hoped by this to accomplish several objects, such as to procure an outlet for cotton, lumber, timber, and to open up the trade of the St. John's River, to cut off a source of commissary supplies to the enemy, to obtain recruits for his colored regiments, and enough white volunteers for at least one regiment. He afterwards added another detail to his plan, to assist in bringing Florida back into the Union, in accordance with the President's proclamation of December 8, 1863. This came in time to be regarded by the opponents of the administration as the sole purpose of the expedition, and Mr. Lincoln has received a great deal of unjust censure for having made a useless sacrifice of life for a political end. His only connection with the matter can be briefly given. When General Gillmore's intention to move into the interior was made known at Washington, one of the President's secretaries, who had formerly served for a few months on General Hunter's staff as a volunteer, and had many acquaintances in that department, asked leave to accompany the expedition. The President, at the suggestion of the Secretary of War, gave him a commission as Assistant Adjutant General, and charged him with a special errand, which will be best explained by the letter which he carried to General Gillmore. I understand an effort is being made by some worthy gentlemen to reconstruct a loyal state government in Florida. Florida is in your department, and it is not unlikely that you may be there in person. I have given Mr. Hay a commission of major, and send him to you with some blank books and other blanks to aid in the reconstruction. He will explain as to the manner of using the blanks, and also my general views on the subject. It is desirable for all to cooperate, but if irreconcilable differences of opinion shall arise, you are master. I wish the thing done in the most speedy way possible, so that when done it lie within the range of the late proclamation on the subject. The detailed labor, of course, will have to be done by others, but I shall be greatly obliged if you will give it such general supervision as you can find consistent with your most strictly military duties. In accordance with this letter, Major Hay was ordered to proceed to Fernandina and other convenient points in Florida for the purpose of extending to the citizens of the state an opportunity of availing themselves of the President's proclamation by signing the oath of allegiance contained in it, and of enrolling themselves as loyal citizens for the purposes mentioned in the proclamation. The special duties assigned him occupied little time. There were few loyal citizens to enroll. The most of his service was as an ordinary staff officer to General Gillmore, and there need be no further mention of him, except to say that the movement to restore a legal state government for Florida at that time failed for lack of material. The expedition to Florida was under the immediate charge of General Truman Seymour, an accomplished and gallant officer of the regular army. He landed at Jacksonville and pushed forward his mounted force 20 miles to Baldwin, the junction of the two railroads to Fernandina and Jacksonville. The march was highly successful. Colonel Guy V. Henry, having captured 8 of the enemy's guns and a large amount of stores, wagons, and horses. Gilmore himself arrived at Baldwin on the 9th of February, and after a full conference and, as he thought, understanding with Seymour, returned to Jacksonville. From there he telegraphed to Seymour on the 11th, not to risk a repulse in advancing on Lake City, but to hold Sanderson's, unless there were reasons for falling back. He reiterated his orders to concentrate at Baldwin, and then went back to Hilton Head. On the 18th, he was surprised at receiving a letter from Seymour, dated the day before, announcing his intention of moving at once to the Suwannee River without supplies, and asking for a strong demonstration of the Army and Navy in the Savannah River to assist his movement. This news was all the more amazing to Gilmore because Seymour, who had all along been opposed to the movement and thought that there was no desire on the part of Florida to return to the Union, now thought the Floridians were tired of the war and, if kindly treated, would soon come back. Gilmore wrote a peremptory letter ordering him to restrict himself to holding Baldwin and the south prong of the St. Mary's River and occupying Palatka and Magnolia, and dispatched a staff officer to Florida with it. He arrived too late. Seymour had made up his mind that there was less risk in going forward than in staying at Baldwin, and like the brave and devoted soldier that he was, had resolved to take the responsibility. He marched rapidly out towards Alusky, where the enemy under General Joseph Finnegan was supposed to be, but came upon them unexpectedly about 2 miles east of that place. The forces were equal in numbers, about 5,500 on each side. The advantage to the Confederates was that they were in a strong position selected by themselves and ready for the fight. General J.R. Hawley, who commanded a brigade of infantry in the battle, says, "We rushed in, not waiting for the proper full formation, and were fought in detail. Seymour made a gallant fight of it. The National Artillery did good service, but to attack an equally brave enemy in position requires a superiority of force, and Seymour's attack was constantly repulsed with heavy loss, until at nightfall he fell back to a new line. He was not pursued, and retired in good order and unmolested to Jacksonville. The Union loss was 1,861, the Confederate 940. This misadventure put an end for the moment to the attempt to occupy Florida. General Gilmore soon afterwards asked that he might be ordered to Virginia to take part in the campaign then opening, an order which General Grant gladly gave. Seymour also went north and was involved in the attack on Meade's right wing in the Wilderness, and was thus once more unfortunate. But whatever his misfortunes, he never lost the respect and esteem of his brother officers as a man of honor, of courage, and of ability. The calumnies of a political nature and origin, which at one time were rife in the press against him, do not even deserve a refutation. In the summer of 1863, the situation in Mexico had assumed so threatening an attitude that Mr. Seward thought it a matter of the utmost urgency to restore the United States flag to some point in Texas. In view of the plan of Napoleon III for the establishment of an empire on our southwestern border, it was every way desirable that the Archduke Maximilian should not find on landing in his new dominion the adjoining state entirely void of any vestige of the national authority. General Banks, although anxious to proceed at once to the capture of Mobile, was instructed first to hoist the flag in some point of Texas with the least possible delay. The point to be selected was nominally left to his own discretion, but General Halleck strongly urged upon him a combined military and naval movement up the Red River to Alexandria or Shreveport and the military occupation of northern Texas. He said that, by adopting the line of the Red River, Banks would retain his connection with his own base and separate still more the already dissevered sections of the Confederacy, and also cut off the sources of supply from Texas to northern Louisiana and Arkansas. A considerable interchange of views took place between Banks and Halleck. Banks objected to the movement inland by the river, on account of low water and other reasons that were afterwards proved to be sound, and preferred a movement upon Texas by way of the coast. He decided to make a descent at Sabine Pass, where the river Sabine, which forms the boundary between Louisiana and Texas, empties into the Gulf. Thence he expected by a rapid march to occupy the town of Houston, the capital of Texas, which was less than 100 miles from Sabine. It was the 5th of September before the preparations for the expedition could be completed. On that day, 4,000 troops, under General W.B. Franklin, sailed from New Orleans, convoyed by 4 light draft vessels. The transports got to the pass on the morning of the 7th, and the gunboats in the evening. The next day the gunboats engaged the fort unsuccessfully. The Clifton and the Sachem, after considerable damage had been done to them, hauled down their flags. The army abandoned the expedition and withdrew with the 2 uninjured gunboats. This expedition having failed, Banks immediately tried to carry out the instructions of the government by a movement westward from Bayou Teche. But becoming aware of the impracticability of this scheme, before his preparations had made much progress, he gave it up and resolved instead upon the occupation of the country at the mouth of the Rio Grande. He organized a small force under the command of General N.J. T. Dana, and accompanied by 3 naval vessels, sailed the 26th of October, 1863. On the 2nd of November, he landed at Brazos, Santiago. The next day, he drove away a force of the enemy which was stationed there, and on the 6th, his advance occupied Brownsville. With very little delay, he moved northward along the coast in the direction of Galveston, occupying Port Isabel on the 8th of November, and the troops were transported to Mustang Island, which lies between Corpus Christi Bay and the Gulf. The Confederate works commanding Aransas Pass were handsomely carried by General T.E.G. Ransom, and the whole force, now under General C.C. Washburn, moved upon Pass Caballo, commanding the entrance to Matagorda Bay, which was defended by Fort Esperanza, a strong and well-manned fortification. Before the investment of this work was completed, the Confederates, on the 30th of November, evacuated it, escaping by the long peninsula which leads to the mainland, near the Brazos River. Thus, in a month, Banks had, by good management and good fortune, brought a large portion of the Texas coast under the Union flag. But the formidable works at Galveston and the mouth of the Brazos still confronted him, and he thought that to attack them successfully, it would be necessary to march inland and approach them from the rear. He was not ready for this, but reported progress to Washington and suggested an increase of his forces for further operations. This proposition did not meet with General Halleck's approval. He had never favored the coastwise plan, and he now renewed his suggestion of a movement up the Red River, coupling it with an offer of an additional force from Sherman's army and a cooperating force under Steele from Arkansas. Banks says in his report that he did not feel at liberty to decline participation in the campaign, thus repeatedly pressed upon him, especially as Halleck informed him that the best military opinions of the generals of the West favored it. He therefore concurred in the scheme and promised cordial cooperation. Previous to undertaking it, however, he required Major D.C. Houston, chief engineer of the department, to prepare a memorandum detailing the difficulties in the way of a campaign on the Red River and the measures indispensable for meeting them. It was easier to foresee the obstacles than overcome them. And the expedition started at last, lacking, one may say, all the conditions of success. As General Banks was occupied at the time with duties connected with the establishment of a state government for Louisiana, the organization of the expedition was left in the hands of General W.B. Franklin, an officer of high reputation and ability. The preparations consumed more time than was expected, and it was not until the early days of March that the final arrangements were made. W.T. Sherman, on his return from his march across Mississippi and back, visited Banks at New Orleans, and promised him 10,000 men for the expedition, who were to meet him at Alexandria on the 17th. This force was merely lent to Banks for 30 days from the time they actually entered Red River, and were in no event to go beyond Shreveport. Over Steele's forces, Banks had no control whatever, and received no assistance from them. Through the delay and the ill luck which marked every step of the enterprise, the troops did not get off at the time appointed, and only reached Alexandria on the 25th of March. Sherman's detachment, under General A.J. Smith, was at the mouth of the river on the 11th, where a powerful fleet under D.D. Porter was awaiting him, and the next morning the gunboat started up the river, the troops following in transports. On the 13th, Smith's forces landed at Simsport on the Atchafalaya, and the next day assaulted and captured Fort De Russy with 260 prisoners and 10 guns. Porter's fleet moved up the river, bursting their way through the obstructions with great energy, and arrived at Alexandria on the 15th and 16th, Smith's force also coming up on a latter day, one day better than their promise. This good fortune was, however, counterbalanced by the recall by General McPherson of Ellet's Marine Brigade, an excellent organization, the loss of which reduced the strength of the advancing column nearly 3,000 men. Evil omens multiplied at Alexandria. The river, which ordinarily at that season is at a high stage of water, was very low. Some of the transports and gunboats were unable to pass the falls and return to Mississippi. It became necessary to establish a depot of supplies at Alexandria and a line of transportation between the vessels below and those above the falls. This further reduced the force of Banks more than he could afford. Steele's force was of no use to him, and with these subtractions from his marching strength, there was already no great discrepancy of numbers between him and Kirby Smith, who had the enormous advantage of fighting on the defensive and of being acquainted with every inch of the ground which was an unknown wilderness to Banks. There was, of course, the valuable help of the Navy, but when the time of crisis came, the Navy was out of reach. While Banks was at Alexandria, he received a letter from Grant which would have justified him in an immediate return to New Orleans. It enforced upon him the prompt return of Sherman's detachment at the time specified, even if such a course should lead to the abandonment of the main object of the expedition. Grant's mind was occupied with the opening of the spring campaign. He said in a subsequent dispatch that he would much rather that the Red River expedition had never been begun than that Banks should be detained one day beyond the 1st of May in commencing the movement east of the Mississippi. Fettered by such instructions as these, with the days in which he was to be allowed to accomplish his difficult task numbered beforehand, with his not too liberal forces diminishing every hour, without, as it afterwards appeared, the confidence or regard of his subordinate officers, General Banks began his unfortunate march towards Shreveport. The army reached Natchitoches, 80 miles from Alexandria, on the 2nd and 3rd of April. The fleet and the transports, with Smith's corps and the stores, arriving at the same time at Grand Accord, 4 miles away. General Banks had remained behind for a few days in Alexandria, where elections were held on the 2nd for the Union Convention of Louisiana. He anticipated no serious resistance short of Shreveport. His information led him to believe that the enemy was fortifying the Sabine River. So far from apprehending a battle on the way to Shreveport, he was only anxious lest he should not be able to obtain one there. He wrote in this vein to Washington, and Mr. Lincoln, with that instinct of the approach of bad news, which seemed like a sixth sense in him, said, "I am sorry to hear this tone of confidence. The next news we shall hear from there will be a defeat." General Banks joined the army as soon as the election was over. He was not alone in his feeling of confidence. No such preparations were made as to indicate that the subordinate generals expected any serious interruption in their long march of 100 miles from Natchitoches to Shreveport. through a barren, sandy country, with little water and less forage, the greater portion an unbroken pine forest, traversed by a narrow wood road. On the 6th of April, the army moved towards Shreveport, General A. L. Lee, with the cavalry in advance, followed by the infantry of Banks's army, under the immediate command of General Franklin, under whom were Generals Ransom and W. H. Emory, and Colonel W. H. Dickey, with a colored brigade. A. J. Smith's detachment followed, a day's journey behind, and a division, under General T. Kelby Smith, accompanied Admiral Porter on the river as a guard for the transports. The order of march was severely criticized after the event. Immediately behind the cavalry came their unwieldy train, blocking up the narrow road and leaving no space free in front of the infantry. The column wound wearily on among the dense woods on a single execrable road, encumbered by 12 miles of wagons bearing the provisions and ammunition of the army in the heart of a hostile wilderness. It was inevitable that when the head of this loose-jointed column struck against any serious obstacle, disaster should follow. The Confederates, under General Richard Taylor, had been falling back before the Union advance all the way up the river. He had received on the 21st of March, at Henderson's Hill, a severe blow from a force under General J. A. Mower, who surprised his camp in a storm of rain and captured his only cavalry regiment. Destitute for the moment of horse, he retired still further on the road to Shreveport until he came to the village of Mansfield, where he halted and occupied the roads leading to Texas and to Shreveport, from which he received heavy reinforcements, Thomas Green's cavalry being a welcome arrival from the south. Being now strong enough to dispute the narrow road with Banks, he moved out to Sabine Crossroads and there formed line of battle with the divisions of J. G. Walker, Alfred Mouton, and Greene, 11,000 effectives, by Confederate reports, with 5,000 men of Price's army, General Kirby Smith says, within one day's march of him. This army, fully equal to that which was struggling towards it through the dense forest, was drawn up in a position that doubled its effectiveness, in the edge of the woods, commanding a rather wide clearing. All day, the 7th of April, General Lee had been skirmishing with Greene's cavalry, who made such resistance to the Union advance as was necessary to allow Taylor to make his preparations for battle undisturbed. A little after midday, Lee, who had asked for and received two brigades of infantry under Ransom from General Franklin, came upon the enemy in position and in force, and at the same time General Banks, who had been riding forward all day through his scattered army, trying to hurry them on, came upon the field. He saw at once the threatening aspect of affairs, told Lee to hold his ground, and sent urgent orders for the rest of the troops to come up. But it was already too late. It was not, indeed, the intention of Kirby Smith that a decisive battle should be fought at that place. He wished merely that a thorough reconnaissance should be made. Taylor himself thought he was confronted only by cavalry, at least as late as noon of the day of battle. And, in effect, when the shock came, the resistance made to the Confederate attack amounted to little more. About 4 o'clock, Mouton's division attacked with great energy on the left of the road, and Walker on the right, and after a short contest, the cavalry of Lee and their slender infantry supports gave way, General Ransom being wounded, and fled to the rear, where they were instantly mingled in an inextricable confusion with cavalry trains. An attempt was made to stay the rout by R. A. Cameron's division of the 13th Corps, which came upon the field at 5 o'clock, accompanied by General Franklin. But the effort was ineffectual. The whole force dissolved in disorderly retreat. The infantry and cavalry streamed to the rear as they could, in chaotic confusion, and the Confederates reaped a rich harvest of wagons and guns. A little before nightfall, Emory's division of the 19th Corps came up and formed across the road about 3 miles from where the fight began. The routed mass of men, horses, and wagons poured down the road which was left open for their retreat, and Taylor's successful force, rushing on in hot pursuit, was brought to a stand by Emory and checked until night came on. Banks made no mistake in recognizing the full extent of his mishap. He could not, after this check, fight his way to Shreveport within the time allowed by General Grant, and another defeat, on his present ground, which was not improbable in view of the heavy force of the enemy and the broken condition of his own command, would be an irreparable disaster to both army and navy. He therefore gave the order to fall back on Pleasant Hill, which was done in the early morning of the 9th of April. A.J. Smith's force was there, and what was left of Lee's and Ransom's, now under command of Cameron. These forces, the Black Brigade under Dickey and Emory's division, which was in good spirits from the success of the night before, were put in position to await the attack of Taylor. He set out in pursuit as soon as the morning light showed him that Banks had retreated. The Confederates had been reinforced in the night by T. J. Churchill's and M. M. Parsons' divisions. Mouton had been killed in the onset of the day before, and his division was commanded by C. J. Polignac. Taylor, after skirmishing for several hours, attacked at 5 o'clock, his first serious blow falling on the Union left, where Colonel Lewis Benedict was killed and his brigade outflanked and routed. For a moment it looked as if the disaster of Sabin Crossroads was to be repeated, but Emory and Mower stood firm and checked the advancing enemy, and rallying, charged in their turn and drove back the entire Confederate line. General Kirby Smith himself says, Taylor's troops were repulsed and thrown into confusion, and adds that they were completely paralyzed by their repulse. Inspirited by this decisive success, Banks's first impulse was to move again upon Shreveport in pursuit of Taylor's beaten forces. But the representations of all his generals, with the exception of A.J. Smith, induced him to continue his retrograde movement to Grand Ecore. The reasons given for this determination were the absence of water, the fact that the provision trains were already far in the rear and could not be reversed promptly in the single forest road, the impracticability of ascending the river in the low water, and the consequent danger of the loss of the fleet, the diminished numbers of the army, and the rigorous orders of Grant against keeping Smith's force a moment beyond the time specified in their loan. He sent word for the fleet to return, and on the 10th the army went back to Grand Ecore. The fleet had worked its way up the river to Springfield Landing on the 10th, and immediately after received news of the disaster of Sabine Crossroads. They started down the river at once, but were greatly annoyed by constant attacks from Confederates on either shore. They had a severe fight on the 15th, lasting some 2 hours. A large force of General Thomas Greene's cavalry, with field artillery, attacked the fleet from the right bank and tried to capture a transport which had disabled her wheel. This unprecedented battle resulted in a severe defeat for the Confederates. Greene was killed, and some 700 of his force killed and wounded. The Admiral and Kilby Smith joined the army at Grand Ecore the next day. The river was now falling rapidly, and the condition of the fleet was becoming most critical. Banks received the letter from General Grant, already mentioned, expressly forbidding anything which should prevent his return to New Orleans later than the 1st of May. The only business before him, therefore, was to see to the safety of the fleet and then abandon the expedition. The fleet was brought to the Falls of Alexandria in safety through the bold and energetic efforts of the Admiral and his officers. The Eastport, the finest ship in the fleet, was sunk by a torpedo, and although she was raised and kept afloat for 50 miles by tremendous exertions on the part of her gallant commander, S. L. Phelps, she finally grounded on a raft of logs at Montgomery and had to be blown up. Admiral Porter, who after seeing the rest of the fleet safe to Alexandria, had gone back with 3 small gunboats to the rescue of the Eastport, had to fight every inch of his way back. His little vessels were riddled with shots from the Confederate artillerymen on the bank and on the Admiral's flagship. In one fight, the pilot was wounded and the engineer killed at the same moment. Few passages of the war called for more courage and skill than were displayed by Admiral Porter and his brave subordinates in that little known but most difficult achievement of the withdrawal of the fleet from Grand Ecore. The army got safely back to Alexandria on the 26th after a brilliant engagement with a Confederate force under General H.P. Bee at Cane River, in which Bee was quickly and thoroughly defeated. On arriving at Alexandria, Banks found General David Hunter awaiting him with peremptory dispatches ordering him to bring his expedition to an end without delay. General A.J. Smith, whose 30 days had expired, was naturally anxious to return to Sherman, but Banks, feeling that the rescue of the fleet was a matter of prime importance, refused to allow him to go. General McClernand arrived on the 29th, bringing reinforcements from Matagorda by order of General Grant. General Hunter went away on the 30th, with dispatches giving a full account of the situation, and later Banks received a dispatch from Halleck, dated the same day, countermanding the order for the abandonment of the expedition. But these dispatches had now little value on either side. The water was so low that the gunboats could not ascend the river, which put an advance out of the question. The whole energies of the army were devoted to the one object of saving the fleet, which was in a position of the gravest danger. It was the season of the year when, according to all precedent, the river should have been at high water, but, as if the forces of nature were at league with the enemy to make the national disaster complete, the long line of the falls, about a mile in extent, showed a mass of jagged rocks above the surface, while the water in the channel gave a depth in its shallowest parts of less than 4 feet. The current was extremely swift, running about 10 miles an hour. Most men in the Army and Navy thought of nothing but to wait where there were in the slightest hope of a providential rise of the river, which would allow the vessels to pass the falls and gain the navigable water below Alexandria. But there was one man who knew perfectly well what to do and how to do it. This was Lieutenant Colonel Joseph Bailey of the 4th Wisconsin, serving on General Franklin's staff as chief engineer. He had had large experience in building dams in the Northwest and had floated and saved 2 Confederate transports which the Army found lying in the mud near Port Hudson. During the entire campaign, his mind had been preoccupied with the peril in which the constantly falling water would involve the Navy. The ascent of the river had been hard enough and attended with danger at every step. The water had since then fallen 6 feet, with no signs of a rise. The fleet was inevitably lost if the Army should retire. Nothing but a dam could save it. Yet the difficulties in the way of a dam seemed almost insuperable. At the point just above the lower chute, which Bailey's intelligent eye had selected, the river was 758 feet wide, with a fall of 6 feet below. He had to effect a rise of about 7 feet to save the fleet. He was sure he could do it. He found no difficulty in persuading General Franklin of the feasibility of his plan, but Admiral Porter, General Franklin says, derided the project. Bailey, sure of himself, persisted, and with the aid of Franklin presented his plan to Banks and Hunter. Without any certainty of success, but anxious to avail himself of every possible expedient, Banks gave the necessary orders and details, and the whole army in an efficient detail from the fleet turned in to accomplish the formidable task. We believe there is no record of a work of equal importance performed in so short a time. The dam was begun on the 30th of April and finished on the 8th of May. On the north side of the river, a dam was constructed of trees laid with their tops towards the current, cross-tied with heavy timbers, and weighted with all the heavy material available. On the south, as timber could not be obtained, heavy cribs were constructed from the proceeds of the demolition of some ruined mills and barns, and filled with brick and stone and all the iron that could be found. Between the cribs and the tree dam, the vacant space, 150 feet, was filled by sinking 4 large coal barges across the stream. The men worked with the greatest patience and enthusiasm, standing waist-deep in the water under a broiling sun by day and in the lurid light of flambeaux and fires by night. Amid the jeers of the disloyal and the doubting, the work went on, and not until a week had passed was there any general belief in its success. By the 8th of May, the results were so evident in the rapidly rising water that no doubt remained. The next day the fleet could have been brought down to the chute, but in the morning the tremendous pressure of the pent-up waters began to force the coal barges out of place. Not an instant was to be lost. Admiral Porter jumped on a horse and galloped at headlong speed to the upper fall and ordered the Lexington to go through them and then to run for the dam. She got over the upper fall and rushed with a full head of steam for the opening in the dam. In the midst of breathless silence from the thousands of spectators on the shore, she entered the gap, pitched down the roaring torrent, made two or three spasmodic rolls, hung for a moment on the rocks below, and was swept into deep water by the current and rounded to safely into the bank. 30,000 voices rose in one deafening cheer. The Neosho followed next. Her pilot became alarmed and stopped his engine as he approached the roaring abyss. The ship plunged under the water for a moment, but rose and was swept on by the current little damaged. Two more vessels came through successfully, but by this time the water had fallen so far that no more could make the passage. Bailey, undeterred by this mischance, simply left a gap of 55 feet at the lower dam. Built a series of wing dams at the upper falls, by which all the water of the river was turned into a narrow channel, and in this way a sufficient rise was obtained to bring all the vessels over in safety on the 13th of May. Bailey was made a brigadier general and thanked by Congress for this valuable service, and the officers of the Mississippi Squadron gave him a sword of honor. He earned new laurels a few days afterwards when the army and fleet were on their way to New Orleans by bridging the Atchafalaya at Simsport with boats. On the 18th of May, a sharp engagement took place between A.J. Smith's command and the Confederates under the lead of Polignac and Wharton, in which the latter was repulsed. On the 20th at Simsport, General Banks gave up the command of the troops to General E.R.S. Canby, who had been put in charge of the military division of the West Mississippi. General Banks retained command of the Department of the Gulf. We prefer not to enter into the bitter discussions to which this disastrous campaign gave rise on both sides of the line. A lifelong quarrel sprang up between Kirby, Smith, and Taylor, between Banks and Porter, while Franklin, Charles P. Stone, Banks's chief of staff, and Albert L. Lee, all of whom relinquished their commands, added their quota of misunderstanding and resentment. Leaving out all questions of mutual recriminations, it seems that the statement made by General Banks in March 1865 gives in the fewest possible words the causes of the failure of the expedition. The difficulties of navigation, the imperfect concentration of forces, the incautious march of the 8th of April, and a limited time allotted to the expedition. The Committee on the Conduct of the War made an investigation of the matter in the year 1865, at the time when the antagonism between Mr. Lincoln and the Radicals in relation to the subject of Reconstruction had assumed an acute form, and they seized upon the occasion to deal a severe blow at the President and Secretary of State for ordering the expedition, and at Banks, whose obedience to the President's orders in setting on foot the civil administration of Louisiana was regarded by Senators Chandler and Wade and Representatives Julian and Lone as an interference with the prerogative of Congress for his conduct of it. We have shown in another place how important were the intrigues and designs of foreign powers in relation to Texas, which seemed to Lincoln and Seward sufficient reason for wishing the flag set up in that state, even at some sacrifice. The charge was made by the committee against Banks that what he had in view was to carry out measures for the establishment of a state government in Louisiana and to afford an egress for cotton and other products of that region, and that the attention directed to the accomplishment of these objects exerted an unfavorable influence on the expedition. The four members of the committee mentioned above united in this report of censure, and Mr. Gooch presented a minority report wholly dissenting from this opinion. We have fully noticed in another place the measures taken by Banks for the establishment of a state government in Louisiana. These were mainly taken by order of the President, and upon him, and not upon the General, should fall the responsibility of them. The plan with which the committee charge him, and which has been for 20 years the theme of endless criticism, that of affording an outlet for cotton and other products, was also, within proper limits, in accordance with the policy of the government. The need for cotton was so great, here and abroad, that every proper means for obtaining it, and therefore relieving the famine with which the world was suffering, was eagerly embraced by the government. In May, 1863, General Banks had urged upon the government a plan for the requisition of cotton in Louisiana, which, he thought, would have resulted in securing from $50 to $100 million worth of cotton on the lower Mississippi. This was to purchase cotton from its holders within the rebel lines, through their friends in the Union lines, at the prices current where it was grown, which was only a third or a quarter its value in Liverpool. The government to receive not only the cash profits on the transaction, but the vastly greater advantage, which would come from continuing to the world something like its normal supply of an indispensable product. But this proposition did not receive the approval of the government, and captured and abandoned property continued to be turned over to the officers of the War or Treasury Department, according to the regulations promulgated from Washington. Banks gave no permits or privileges to trade. There were many vague charges of improper conduct made by prejudiced persons in the press and before the Committee of Congress. But there was never any proof brought forward to contradict General Banks's unqualified statement. Every dollar's worth of property that came into the hands of the Army during this campaign was either appropriated to its use in kind by the proper officers of the Commissary and Quartermaster's Department, receipts being given therefor or transmitted to the Chief Quartermaster at New Orleans, and by him turned over to the Treasury agents, to be disposed of according to the laws of Congress and the orders of the government. When cotton or other property interfered with the transportation of any material of the army or of refugees, negroes, or troops upon the evacuation of the country, it was thrown from the boats and abandoned upon the river levee to the enemy. A large amount of cotton was seized by the Navy and sent to Cairo to be adjudicated under the prize law, and the proceeds distributed among its captors, which was regularly and legally done. A vast quantity of cotton was burnt by the Confederates to prevent it from falling into Union hands. Reflections more or less severe were cast upon the President, because two men appeared at Alexandria bearing passes in his handwriting, authorizing them to trade in cotton. The pressure upon him to grant these permits was almost incredible, and he sometimes, though very seldom, gave way to it. A letter which he wrote in the summer of 1863 to a valued personal and political friend, a man of great prominence in Illinois, shows the pressure he had to contend against. "I have received and read your pencil note. I think you do not know how embarrassing your request is. Few things are so troublesome to the government as the fierceness with which the profits of trading in cotton are sought. The temptation is so great that nearly everybody wishes to be in it. And when in, the question of profit controls all, regardless of whether the cotton seller is loyal or rebel, or whether he is paid in cornmeal or gunpowder. The officers of the army, in numerous instances, are believed to connive and share the profits, and thus the army itself is diverted from fighting the rebels to speculating in cotton. And steamboats and wagons in the pay of the government are set to gathering and carrying cotton, and the soldiers to loading cotton trains and guarding them. The matter deeply affects the Treasury and War Departments, and has been discussed again and again in the Cabinet. What can and what cannot be done has for the time been settled, and it seems to me I cannot safely break over it. I know it is thought that one case is not much, but how can I favor one and deny another? One case cannot be kept a secret. The authority given would be utterly ineffectual until it is shown, and when shown, everybody knows it. The administration would do for you as much as for any other man, and I personally would do some more than for most others. But really, I cannot involve myself and the government as this would do.
Later,
when the war was ending and the evil consequences of this trade were greatly lessened, the President gave a few of these permits, strictly enjoining, however, upon the officers of the government, civil and military, that they were in no case to be allowed to interfere with military movements or the regular operations of the Treasury. Among others, permits were given to his old friend William Butler of Springfield and to Thomas L. Casey. The appearance of these two favored beings in a camp so full of suspicion and malevolence as that unhappy camp at Alexandria produced a plentiful crop of fantastic fictions. They had bought Kirby Smith. They were scheming to elect Banks or Governor Yates to the presidency. With the money they were to coin out of their cotton, the army was to be sacrificed, the navy was to be robbed, that these vampires might fatten on the ruin of the country. Butler and Casey profited little by their permits, and so far from commanding the army and navy in their cotton quest, they were not allowed to keep the little cotton they collected. Both Porter and Banks agree in saying their cotton was taken away from them by the army and put to military uses, some of it being worked into the famous dam on the Red River. There was, of course, more or less of the peculation and concussion which attend in the trail of a great war, but in the midst of all the painful controversies that grew out of the Red River mischance, it is gratifying to know that no officer of rank in Army or Navy was shown to be guilty of any act of dishonesty. The honorable poverty in which General Banks has passed his subsequent life is the best answer to the reckless charges of his enemies. End of chapter 11.